In the history of warfare, some campaigns are remembered as glorious demonstrations of the profession of arms. But there are other chapters of military history that arouse far less passion and enthusiasm. One example dates from the later years of the Second World War. Between 1943 and 1945, the Allies fought an offensive campaign that became one of the least remembered episodes of the conflict. The campaign in Italy. In the end, it was a successful campaign. The Allied forces were victorious. But success in Italy took time. 20 long months of fighting were required before Italy was fully in Allied hands. It was a campaign that saw some of the bloodiest exchanges of the whole war, often in the harshest of battle conditions. The weather and the landscape made the Italian campaign a miserable experience for the individual soldier. For the Allied troops, there was also the suspicion of poor decision-making by some of their commanders. On a number of crucial occasions, senior officers gave orders that can now be seen as dubious, if not worse. The names of Italian battlefields like Anzio and Monte Cassino are not associated with brilliant Allied decision-making. The deployment of American bombers against the Cassino Monastery remains one of the most controversial operations of the Second World War. By the time the Italian campaign neared its end, many exhausted Allied troops wondered if the whole enterprise had been little more than a sideshow to more dramatic events in other theatres of operation. But warfare is not always about dash and brilliance, and solid, slow-moving campaigns can deliver real strategic value. In the course of the battle for Italy, the Allies succeeded in tying down hundreds of thousands of German troops that could have fought elsewhere. And there were occasions when commanders of both sides revealed a military skill to match the bravery of the men under their command. There is still much to be remembered about the battlefield of Italy. In January 1943, the British Prime Minister and the President of the United States met to discuss the progress of the Second World War. At the Casablanca Conference, Winston Churchill and Franklin D. Roosevelt could reflect on the changing fortunes of the fight against the Axis powers. In the North African lands to the east of Casablanca, the Allies were well on their way to driving the Germans and Italians out of the region for good. The British-led First Army stood on a front line in Tunisia, waiting for the right moment to strike east against the ports of Tunis and Bizerta. At the same time, the 8th Army of General Montgomery continued its pursuit of Rommel's Panzerarmee that began in the aftermath of El Alamein. On the Eastern Front, the fortunes of the Allies were also beginning to change by January 1943. At Stalingrad, the Soviet Union stood poised on the edge of victory in one of the bloodiest and most significant battles in history. Far away in the Pacific, the Japanese were preparing to withdraw from the island of Guadalcanal after months of bitter jungle fighting. The age of unchecked Japanese expansion was over. And the war situation was very different to that of 12 months before. There was no doubt that on three separate fronts, the tide of the war was turning. The question that faced the Allied leadership was simple. Where next to strike against Hitler and the Axis enemy? as preparations continued for the Normandy landings of 1944, it was decided that Allied forces would launch an additional strike against the home soil of Hitler's greatest ally, the Italian dictator Benito Mussolini. When victory in North Africa was secured on May the 13th, 1943, preparations were already well advanced for an invasion of Sicily. If the Allies could make a successful leap across from North Africa and capture the island, the door to the Italian mainland itself would be open. To lead the operation, the regional command appointed two heroes of the African fighting. Dwight Eisenhower and his British deputy Harold Alexander decided that the invasion of Sicily required the deployment of two Allied armies: the American 7th Army of General George S. Patton and the legendary British 8th Army, the Desert Rats of Bernard Montgomery. The operation was given the codename Husky, and D-Day was set for the evening of the 9th and the 10th of July 1943. Eisenhower and Alexander knew that their invasion force was experienced and well-equipped. Together, the two Allied armies could muster a total of 180,000 men. But they also knew that the Sicily offensive would face stiff opposition. The island was home to over 300,000 Italian troops. It was also the base for some 40,000 Germans, including the men of the elite Hermann Göring Panzer Division. There is no doubt that the Allied command was concerned about facing German troops like these. But when it came to their Italian colleagues, there was real doubt about their stomach for continuing the war. The fighting in North Africa had done nothing for the reputation of the Italian fighting man. In Western eyes, Mussolini's forces were more famous for their mass surrenders than their effectiveness in combat. Patton and Montgomery could not know for sure what kind of response there would be as their men made ready for action. But they did know that they'd already pulled off one of the most imaginative deceptions of the Second World War. In May, the body of an Allied serviceman was found washed up on the Spanish coast. The dead man was carrying secret documents, giving details of the next Allied assault against the island of Sardinia, not Sicily. Spain was supposedly neutral, but Franco's sympathies with the Axis powers meant that the secret documents soon found their way to German eyes. The nature of the find meant that the information was believed by German intelligence. When the Allies attacked Sicily, the Germans believed that it was only a decoy offensive. They were soon proved wrong. For the Allies, the invasion of Sicily represented the first attempt to engage the enemy on his home ground, and the officers in charge felt confident of success. But Operation Husky was not as straightforward as the Allied command would have liked, and the fighting that took place gave a hint of the type of campaign that lay ahead in Italy. The Sicilian offensive was arranged as a joint operation, beginning with simultaneous amphibious and airborne landings to the south of the island. On the evening of the 9th, Allied paratroop carriers and glider pullers took to the skies to drop a total of 4,000 men. But the result was a near disaster. Poor navigation meant that 70 British gliders were forced to land in the sea, and 200 men were lost as a result. It was a worrying start to Operation Husky. The battle for Sicily began in earnest just minutes after the Allied landings. As expected, it was German forces who resisted hardest. Many American paratroopers came under fire before they hit the ground. But despite the problems with the airborne landings, the amphibious element of Operation Husky proved a success. Within 24 hours, the Americans and British established a tentative beachhead along 85 miles of Sicilian coastline. Six days into the operation, the Anglo-American landing force was securely established along the South Sicilian coast. Back in Rome, the Italian leader's hold on power was beginning to slip away. With the Sicilian landings achieved, the Allied task was now to advance north, to secure the ports of Palermo and Messina and open the way to the Italian mainland. Montgomery's 8th Army were allocated to the sector at the east of the island, in the direction of Mount Etna. Patton's 7th were ordered to sweep around to the west before heading towards Messina along Sicily's northern coast. It was not an easy enterprise. On July the 13th, a detachment of British commandos found itself involved in a fierce battle for possession of the Ponte di Malati bridge. It was clear that the Germans were not prepared to concede Sicily without a fight. Montgomery's troops met with especially strong German resistance south of Catania, and the British commander was forced to make a detour through the hilly terrain around Mount Etna. It was hot, sweaty, and dusty. The absence of good roadways was a real hindrance, and thirsty foot soldiers were compelled to carry heavy loads of material as the enemy continued to resist. German defenders adopted the tactics of vigorous defense, followed by controlled withdrawal behind destroyed transport routes. It was a procedure that would also reveal itself on the larger battlefield of Italy. As a result, Montgomery's men found progress difficult in late July and early August 1943. By contrast, Patton's army found itself in easier terrain with lighter defenses. Many of the Italian troops surrendered without any sort of fight. At some of the original landing zones, Italian troops helped the Allies ashore. There was now no doubt that many ordinary Italians were disillusioned with their country's alliance with Hitler. Many American troops described the rapturous reception that they received from Sicily's inhabitants. But it still took Patton some 5.5 weeks to reach his objective of Messina, just 2 hours before his British colleagues arrived. The date was August the 17th. Despite the weakness of Italian resistance, the conquest of Sicily was still a costly enterprise. Over 30,000 Allied men were killed, captured, or wounded. But in the final advance on Messina, both Allied armies encountered little in the way of opposition. As early as July the 29th, Field Marshal Kesselring ordered a strategic withdrawal of his forces, and some 100,000 men made it across to the Italian mainland, the majority of them German. The Wehrmacht was still keen to take up the fight. The same could not be said of their Italian allies. Events in Sicily proved once again that many ordinary Italian soldiers did not share the pro-German sentiments of their political master. And Italian politics finally caught up with reality in the course of the Allied offensive. For Mussolini, the loss of Sicily was one humiliation too many. On the 25th of July, in a palace coup, the old dictator was ousted and placed in detention. The 21-year reign of Il Duce was at an end. His replacement was Marshal Pietro Badoglio, who immediately began discussions with the Allies. A change of sides was now on the cards. The fall of Mussolini was a massive boost for the Allied cause, and as September began, the Anglo-American forces in Sicily were preparing the next logical step forward: the conquest of Italy. On the 17th of August 1943, General George S. Patton basked in his own glory as the liberator of Messina. Just 3 weeks later, the Allied conquest of Italy would begin. But Patton would not be involved in the fighting. During the Sicily campaign, the charismatic general made a serious error of judgment. He physically attacked two of his own injured men, whom he believed to be cowards. It was an unsavory incident, and Patton was withdrawn from the region. In 1944, he made a memorable comeback in Normandy, but Patton's role in the Italian enterprise came to an end in Sicily. Instead, General Mark Clark took over as commander of the American 5th Army, part of the Allied 15th Army group of Harold Alexander, under the overall command of Dwight Eisenhower. By the end of August, Clark's 5th Army and Montgomery's 8th knew what their tasks would be in the invasion that lay ahead. In its conception, the attack on Italy was a mainly British idea. Eisenhower and his political masters in Washington were not wholly convinced of its merits. It was made clear to the British that the preparations for the Normandy landings took priority over events in the south. But the American leadership could appreciate that an invasion of Italy was likely to tie down large numbers of German troops. It was almost impossible to imagine Hitler allowing his old ally to fall without a fight. But this meant that fierce German resistance was all but certain. And the Allied commanders knew that another obstacle lay ahead. The Italian landscape itself was also likely to cause serious problems. The land of the Italian peninsula itself represents a formidable opponent for any army set on invasion. In the center of the country, the peaks of the Apennine Mountains dominate the physical environment. Progress northwards is only possible on the flanks, but here too there are peaks, forming a mountainous rib structure extending from the central Italian spine. There are also fast-flowing rivers running between the mountain ribs, set in valleys that provide ideal cover for defensive positions. All the way up the country, Italy is naturally divided into individual blocks of ideal defensive terrain. The line stretching northeast from the coast 100 miles to the south of Rome presents an especially strong natural barrier. But the Allies knew that this area around the mountain known as Cassino would have to be captured. This was the only direct route through to the Lira Valley and the main highway to Rome. In 1943, Monte Cassino itself was the strongest obstacle of all. Its formidable natural defenses had been recognized long before the Second World War. In AD 529, St. Benedict chose to build a great Christian monastery on the peak, and despite wars and sieges over the centuries, the great monastery remained on Monte Cassino in the autumn of 1943. Predictably, the Germans chose to build a substantial defensive line running from coast to coast through the Monte Cassino region. Before the fighting in Sicily was over, Field Marshal Kesselring ordered a devastating structure of mines, booby traps, bunkers, and gun positions to be set up. By the end of the year, the work was completed, presenting another barrier to Allied progress. This was the so-called Winter Line. Around Cassino, the line was strengthened further by its position behind the rivers Garigliano and Rapido, both of which were likely to swell in the rainy months of autumn and winter. In this sector, the line was known as the Gustav Line, and a direct assault against it was bound to be an exhausting enterprise. Even if it was crossed and Rome was then taken, the Allies could also suspect that a skilled defensive force might regroup further north and form new lines to thwart offensive progress. As events transpired, this was exactly the scenario that evolved as the massive forces of the Allies and the Axis engaged on the battlefield of Italy. It is typical of the story of World War II that the entire Italian campaign was seen by many as little more than a diversionary episode. Many Americans in particular shared this view at the time. But if we wish to see the Italian campaign as just a sideshow, then we must also accept that it was a sideshow that involved two whole army groups comprising hundreds of thousands of men, and it took 20 months for the fighting to reach its conclusion. In that time, the dispositions of the two sides changed, depending on the withdrawals and reinforcements of divisional manpower. Both sides were forced to accept that Italy was not the only theatre of operation at the time. But a typical order of battle showed 20 or more divisions on either side of the Italian front line during the course of the fighting. Inevitably, these included substantial armoured resources. But the nature of the Italian landscape meant that the role of the tank could not be as overwhelming as it was in North Africa. Italy was a battlefield where the talent and endurance of the individual infantryman was often as important as the power of any tank. In the villages and mountains of the Italian peninsula, the skills of the sniper proved invaluable. The ability to endure harsh weather conditions was also essential. On many occasions, fighting ground to a halt as offensives petered out and stalemate battles of attrition began. In these situations, the Allied commanders knew that maintaining morale amongst their men was a vital aspect of their duty. Even the hardest soldiers found it tough going in wet, wintry conditions in the Italian mountains, especially in the absence of any progress in the fighting. For both sides, the big guns had a crucial role to play as the Italian campaign unfolded. On a number of occasions, Allied attacks were preceded by artillery barrages of murderous intensity. The American 155mm gun was just one of the devastating weapons deployed. The Allies could also call on awesome power from the air, as the monks of Monte Cassino found out. But the Germans could also call on huge artillery pieces, including one giant gun that may be the best remembered weapon of the Italian campaign. Gunners on both sides were kept busy throughout the Italian campaign, as were their colleagues, the engineers. As the Allies made their slow advance north, their progress was hampered at all stages by the activities of German sappers. German withdrawals were accompanied by the destruction of the transport links that they left behind, and many companies of engineers were given the job of blowing up bridges and roadways. There was also much work to be done when the German command decided to make a stand at a defensive line of their own choosing. Again, the German engineers proved their value by defining the nature of the battlefield. In the course of the fighting, two defensive barriers proved especially tough nuts for the Allies to crack: the Gustav Line to the south of Rome and the Gothic Line to the north. At both locations, German engineers constructed fearsome defences in a landscape that was already a barrier to progress. Mines and tripwire booby traps were laid. Camouflaged gun emplacements were constructed. 75mm caliber panzer turrets were set in concrete bases. Anti-tank ditches were dug, and hundreds of miles of barbed wire were laid. the Allied engineers were compelled to counteract the effectiveness of their enemy's works. The mines and booby traps had to be defused. The barbed wire had to be cut. Bailey bridges were required to replace crossings blown by the Germans. Road paths had to be laid so that Allied armor could advance. On many occasions, the Allied engineers were forced to carry out their work as the full force of war raged around them. In one fearsome engagement in the town below Monte Cassino, their task was severely hampered by the activities of their own side. An Allied assault from the air reduced the town to rubble, and it was left to the engineers to make any kind of motorized advance possible. The heavy use of air power was understandable. As the Italian campaign continued, Allied superiority in the air grew more and more decisive. A year into the fighting, the German warplanes in Italy were outnumbered 10-1. From the very beginning of the Italian campaign, the Allies were keen to capture airfields like Foggia near the Adriatic coast, and it was from Foggia that the most infamous operation of the Italian campaign was launched. But the might of American bombers was not enough in itself to secure progress on the ground. And for weeks at a time, the mighty warplanes remained stuck on the ground as rain, snow, and cloud made good visibility impossible. In the final analysis, the most striking difference between the two sides in Italy may not have been defined in strictly military terms. Instead, we may choose to look at the home background of the regiments and divisions involved. The defenders were mainly Germans. Their Allied attackers came from all over the world. The British 8th Army and the American 5th were made up of a bewildering number of nationalities. The British Army was not exclusively British. Just as in North Africa, it drew its manpower from Australia, Canada, and South Africa. New Zealanders were involved in some of the bloodiest engagements. There were Indian contingents, including troops of the legendary Gurkha Rifles. Some Indian soldiers had been engaged continuously since the fighting in Egypt in late 1940, and all Indian units remained keen to get to grips with the enemy in Italy. By early 1944, they were joined by the Polish Corps, a body of 50,000 men, who had endured imprisonment in the Soviet Union after their country was carved up under the terms of the 1939 Nazi-Soviet Pact. The Poles of General Anders were also keen to get into the action. So were the troops of the French Expeditionary Force that fought alongside the Americans. Many of these were natives of North Africa, and their experience of mountain conditions in Morocco and Algeria assisted one of the most crucial breakthroughs in the Italian campaign. On this occasion, it was the French commander General Juin who had the vision to recognize what his men could achieve. Allied troops of all nationalities displayed a real enthusiasm for getting to grips with the enemy throughout the Italian campaign. But as in all conflicts, the men on the ground had to rely on the skills of their commanders if their efforts were to be rewarded with victory. By the end of December 1943, one man stood in charge of the entire Allied presence on the Italian mainland. As commander of 15th Army Group, the British General Harold Alexander became commander-in-chief of all Allied forces in Italy when Dwight Eisenhower withdrew to take part in the planning for the Normandy landings. Alexander was a soldier of vast experience, dating back to his service in the First World War. When conflict broke out again in 1939, he was soon involved in the amazing evacuation of the British Army from the beaches of Dunkirk. A senior command in the jungles of Burma followed, before Churchill appointed him Commander-in-Chief of British Middle East Forces in August 1942. It was Alexander who was in overall command of the great victory at El Alamein, and his remarkable career did not end in Egypt. In the battle for Tunisia that followed, Alexander was appointed commander of the Allied 18th Army Group, where he continued to enjoy an excellent relationship with his subordinate, General Montgomery. The two men first revealed a mutual respect during the fighting in Egypt, and they continued to work well together in Tunisia and then in Sicily. When the invasion of Italy began, Bernard Montgomery remained as 8th Army commander under his old friend Alexander. But in December 1943, Montgomery was also withdrawn to assist in the D-Day preparations. At that point, command of the 8th Army passed to General Oliver Lees, a protege of Montgomery's, who revealed his battlefield skills as commander of 30th Corps during the fighting at El Alamein. As 1944 dawned, Lees was keen to prove himself once more as the Allies sought progress in the Italian peninsula. But the early months of 1944 were a time when the major Allied offensives were not allocated to the British-led 8th Army, but to the American 5th Army, the command of General Mark Clark. Like its predecessor Patton, Clark was a charismatic showman figure whose good looks belied an astute battlefield brain. When the hot-headed Patton was withdrawn after the invasion of Sicily, Clark was a natural choice to lead the American contingent of the Allied forces in Italy. Another veteran of the First World War, Clark's career in the second global conflict began with his appointment as Eisenhower's deputy during the Tunisia campaign. He then took charge of the new American 5th Army. His responsibility meant that he was deeply involved with some of the most controversial episodes of the Italian campaign. It's widely considered that on one critical occasion, Mark Clark allowed his thirst for personal glory to blind him to the real strategic needs of the Allied cause. But his leadership skills and his undoubted charm enabled him to succeed Alexander as an army group commander before the fighting came to an end. Clark's subordinates included General Bernard Freyberg, commander of the New Zealand Corps within the 5th Army. Like so many other commanders of World War II, Freyberg also saw active service in the First World War. What made him different was the fact that he had secured Britain's highest military award in the course of that fighting. 26 years later, Bernard Freyberg, VC, was still in uniform as commander of New Zealand's 2nd Corps, and his courageous leadership in North Africa had made him a hero amongst his men. In the Italian campaign that followed, Freyberg was answerable to General Mark Clark as his direct superior. But Freyberg was also answerable to the government of New Zealand in respect of the troops he commanded. It may be that his concern for their safety led him to argue for the most notorious Allied decision of the Italian campaign. Sadly, it was a decision that failed to prevent the loss of many young New Zealand men. But the Allies were able to call on reinforcements when needed, and in the spring of 1944 saw the arrival of 50,000 brand new troops on the Italian battlefield. These were the men of Polish 2nd Corps, under the command of General Władysław Anders. In the months that followed, Anders' army revealed an intense commitment to the fight. Such passion was essential in the course of a campaign that often took place in the bleakest of fighting environments. The Allies had to deal with a rugged landscape and weather conditions that were often severe. After the fall of Mussolini and the Italian change of sides, it was German troops who were left chiefly responsible for the defense of Italian territory. And in Field Marshal Albert Kesselring, they had a leader they could believe in. The efforts of this gifted soldier made a massive contribution to the difficulties faced by the Allies during the Italian campaign. He was, without doubt, the single dominant figure of the German Regional Command. Born in 1889, Albert Kesselring first trained as a gunner, but by the end of World War I, his talents had secured him a place on Imperial Germany's general staff. In the 1930s, he joined the young Luftwaffe, and by 1939 he was a Luftflotte commander during the invasion of Poland. Kesselring enjoyed a similar command during the Battle of Britain, and despite the German defeat, his career continued to advance. By the time of the Tunisia campaign, Kesselring was commander-in-chief of all German armed forces in the Mediterranean theater. But it was during the Italian campaign that he revealed the full extent of his talent. Time and again, Kesselring proved that he knew his battlefield, and his decisions meant that for much of the time, the Allied campaign was fought on terms dictated by the German commander. Sadly, Kesselring's reputation was sullied by an order given by him in March 1944. In German-controlled Rome, a local resistance group carried out a bomb attack in which 35 SS men died. As a response, the German field marshal ordered the killing of 335 hostages. It was a decision held against him after the war, and Albert Kesselring was convicted of war crimes and sentenced to death. Though the sentence was eventually commuted, the stain on his reputation remained. Many Italians continue to curse the name of Albert Kesselring. But there can be no doubt that in military terms alone, the German commander in Italy proved himself as a leader in the face of the Allied offensive. Of course, the quality of leadership was an important factor for both sides in the Italian conflict. The maintenance of morale was a vital consideration. For the individual soldier on the ground, daily life could be a bleak experience, not just because of the weather or the landscape, but because both sides knew the extent of the firepower available to their enemy. The Italian campaign may not be remembered as an air war, but there were occasions when the Allies needed to call on the destructive power of the heavy bomber. The most famous bombing raid of all was carried out by three types of American warplane. The twin-engined B-25 Mitchells and B-26 Marauders, and the mighty four-engined B-17, the Flying Fortress. A giant of the air, the Boeing Flying Fortress first took off in 1935, and by the time of the Italian campaign, the Type G had already proved itself in Europe. German civilians knew only too well that the 2,000-mile range of the B-17 meant that it became a nightly fixture in German skies. With a bomb load of some 8 tons, it proved ideal for the strategic bombing offensive against Germany. But in Italy, the Flying Fortress was also deployed in a tactical role with equally devastating effect. For sheer destructive power, the B-17 had few rivals, as events at Monte Cassino proved. Allied commanders could also call on massive firepower on the ground. Italy was a battlefield that proved the continuing importance of artillery fire. And the big guns were exactly that. The American M1 had a caliber of 155 millimeters. Its shells weighed over 92 pounds, and its range of almost 5 miles made it ideal for delivering the kind of indirect artillery fire that saps the morale of the toughest soldier. American gunners appreciated the accuracy of the weapon, which soon earned the nickname Long Tom. America's allies also found the M1 to be an ideal heavy artillery piece. The Long Tom was part of the British arsenal well before the end of the war. Another American design that entered British service was the M4 tank, known to the British as the Sherman. At El Alamein, the Sherman proved itself in battle, and although the Italian landscape provided fewer opportunities for tank warfare, Allied commanders knew they had an excellent machine when armored actions were called for. Its protection was a maximum of 75 millimeters. Its main gun delivered a thumping 75 millimeter caliber shell. Its top speed was 29 miles per hour. The American constructors knew that this was an ideal combination. In the course of the war, over 48,000 Shermans were built, more than any other tank anywhere in the world. In a war where armored capabilities were crucial, the Sherman proved itself time and time again. But the Italian campaign also revealed the continuing importance of the individual infantryman on the ground. And British soldiers knew that they had a rifle they could trust in action. The original Lee Enfield weapon was first introduced as far back as 1895. The Enfield No. 4 was first issued in 1903. By the time of the Second World War, this was still the standard issue rifle in the British Army. Italy was a battlefield where the skills of the sniper were often required. The Enfield No. 4 gave the skilled British sniper the reliability he needed to hit a 4-inch target at up to 200 yards, a range that proved ideal for the rugged, close-quarter fighting that took place in Italy. But the No. 4 provided more than just accuracy. The superb design of the bolt action meant that the weapon could deliver some 30 rounds a minute. This was the case as early as 1914, when British infantry used the No. 4 at the Battle of Mons. 30 years later, on the battlefield of Italy, the Lee Enfield No. 4 remained much the same, and it was still the trusted weapon of the British rifleman. But Britain and her allies didn't have a monopoly of excellent weapons in Italy, and the Germans also enjoyed the ability to position their firepower in deliberate, strong positions. As the defenders, Kesselring's forces were able to establish camouflaged emplacements equipped with powerful machine guns. And of all the weapons available to the German machine gunner, the MG-42 remains the most famous of all. The MG-42 began to establish its reputation on the battlefields of North Africa and the Soviet Union. German machine gunners were quick to appreciate the smooth feed of the 50-cartridge belt. They could also take advantage of a remarkable rate of fire. Some 1,550 rounds a minute could be delivered by the MG-42, and it's not surprising that the weapon remains in service in many armies of the present day. For the German infantrymen, the Italian campaign also revealed the importance of the mortar in battle. The high angle of fire that a mortar provides proved ideal in the Italian conditions, as Allied troops were able to confirm. The German 8-centimeter weapon fired an 8-pound bomb, and a well-trained crew could deliver an enviable rate of fire to a range of up to half a mile. Mortars like this gained the respect of the Allies in Italy and elsewhere, and the 8-centimeter design again proved the value of the weapon referred to as the infantryman's artillery. But if the Germans wanted to call on heavy gunfire in Italy, they were rarely short of options. On occasions when Allied armour was deployed, the 7.5-centimeter anti-tank gun could be brought into the fray. With a range of a mile and a half, the PAC-40 was typically used to fire 9-pound shells straight into the enemy line. But it was at closer ranges that the PAC-40 revealed its real strength. At a range of a third of a mile, its shells could penetrate armour to a thickness of over 150 millimetres, and this was more than sufficient to deal with any armoured vehicles available to the Allies. But of all the German weapons used in Italy, the most famous of all of them was nothing less than a monster, the K5 railway gun. This was an artillery piece so big that it needed to be mounted on a railway carriage. After deployment, it could be hidden in tunnels, safe from the attentions of Allied bombers. Even today, its specifications are awesome. Its caliber was 28 centimeters. Its shells weighed a quarter of a ton. Its range was over 50 miles. In January 1944, the Allies encountered this stupendous weapon for the first time, and it remains known by the nickname given to it then. The K5's shells were fired against an Allied amphibious landing at a coastal village 40 miles to the south of Rome, a village whose name has become synonymous with deadlock and stalemate in war. This was the village of Anzio, and the K5 became known as Anzio Annie. In the early months of 1944, this amazing machine played a huge part in battering the Allies at the Anzio beachhead, and its impact was as much psychological as physical. But Anzio was not the first amphibious landing of the Allied offensive in Italy. In August 1943, the Allied command decided to make a first assault further south as part of a twin-pronged assault against the Italian mainland. This was the thinking for the beginning of the Italian campaign, and by early September, the Allied plan was ready to be put into action. With the fall of Sicily and the ousting of Mussolini, the Allied command were keen to strike as soon as possible against the Italian mainland. By the beginning of September, the British-led 8th Army and the American 5th Army were ready for the offensive. As we've seen, these were armies that drew their strength from all over the world, and many of them were already seasoned veterans of the Second World War. The Allied plan was straightforward. In the south, Montgomery's men would make the short sea crossing from Sicily. Once across, they were tasked with seizing the port of Reggio di Calabria before beginning the advance north. This part of the invasion was codenamed Operation Baytown. This could be seen as an attack on Italy's toe, but the plan also called for British airborne troops to land on the heel at the port of Taranto. This support landing was given the codename Slapstick. With these two objectives achieved, the British troops were to advance towards Italy's central regions, where, if all went well, they would be joined by their American colleagues. The job of Mark Clark's 5th Army was more demanding. Operation Avalanche called for the American troops to make an amphibious landing at the port of Salerno, further north. The Allies would have liked to attack further north still, but Salerno represented the most distant objective that could be protected by Allied fighters launched from Sicilian airfields. If Clark's men succeeded in establishing a beachhead at Salerno, it could be used as a starting point for the advance north, in combination with the 8th Army arriving from further south. The first big prize would be Naples, and then Rome itself could be taken. But to do this, the Allies would have to break through the line of German defences in the central mountains. And defence was the key to the German thinking in the Italian campaign. In the battle for Sicily, the German tactics gave the Allies a hint of the kind of fighting that lay ahead on the Italian mainland. After Sicily had fallen, Field Marshal Albert Kesselring was determined that any Allied progress on the mainland would be hard fought, and he devised a strategy to achieve his objective. When German forces did make contact with the enemy, their task was to engage and then, if necessary, make an organized withdrawal, taking care to destroy transport links as they departed. Kesselring knew that the Italian terrain provided an ideal landscape for a series of fortified defensive lines, the most important of which were the Gothic Line in the north and the Winter Line in the centre. This was the defence that included the sector known as the Gustav Line. Kesselring knew that natural obstacles like Monte Cassino would have to be captured if the Allies wanted to secure a path to Rome through the Liri Valley. He also knew that his enemy might be tempted to make an amphibious or airborne outflanking move to secure a position behind the defensive lines. So the German Field Marshal maintained substantial forces in reserve to deal with any Allied outflanking maneuver. Ideally, he hoped to push any Allied beachhead back into the sea. Failing that, he could trap them on the beaches and prevent a breakout. At the coastal town of Anzio, Allied troops had plenty of time to appreciate the skillful planning of Albert Kesselring. But even before the Italian campaign began, the British and Americans knew that the task ahead was likely to be tough, and there was little doubt that the enemy would be fully motivated. But the campaign began with some excellent news for the Allied cause. On the eve of the Salerno landings, the formal surrender of the Italian state was broadcast around the world.
Armistice with Italy has been concluded. It is a great victory for the United Nations, but it was also a great victory for the Italian people. After years of war and suffering and degradation, the Italian people are at last coming to the day of liberation from their real enemies, the Nazis. But let us not delude ourselves that this armistice means the end of war in the Mediterranean. We must drive the Germans out of Italy as we have driven them out of Tunisia and Sicily. We must drive them out of France and all other captive countries.
On the 8th of September 1943, the Allied leadership could be forgiven for believing that the tide of the Second World War was now with them. Great victories had already been secured. Egypt, Tunisia, Sicily. Now it was the turn of Italy, and many Allied soldiers could imagine another decisive triumph ahead. But the reality would be very different.